Leonid Poltirovich from Tel Aviv University, who will talk about the approximate representation of simplex morphisms via quantization. That's one of the wonderful surprises which happened this last year, that suddenly our topic appeared in a completely new direction, at least a new direction for me. I want to take the opportunity to mention that next week we'll have also a kind of a special talk, as it was mentioned briefly during the seminar, that this year there was a big breakthrough of reputing the cons embedding problem using some quantum computation ideas. This is a big piece of work, and we kind of announced here that there are other seminars going parallelly in some parts of the world about that work, but Michael Chapman will give briefly the kind of the structure of this subject, but I also asked him explicitly to try to explain what is needed in order to do also the group theoretic part. We mentioned here many times, or at least several times, the open problem whether every group is hyperlinear, and this is still very much open. And I hope that Michael will explain what is missing if one wants to prove a counterexample to the Kohn's embedding problem, which come from a group algebra. Now I'm telling all this also to say that because of that, this lecture will be longer than the usual. Maybe we'll divide it into two parts. It maybe will be an hour and three quarters instead of an hour and a quarter, maybe with a little break. So those who are at the institute, bring your sandwiches with you for lunch to eat, because it will be slightly longer than usual. And now, Leonid, the stage is yours.
Okay, thank you very much for the invitation. So I will talk about recent work with Laurent Charles on approximate representations and simplectomorphisms. Alex asked me explicitly to give more preliminaries on symplectic geometry, and that's exactly what I will do. So what is this lecture about, right? So the central object of interest is a group of Hamiltonian diffeomorphisms. So this is a central object in symplectic topology, and this is a huge group. So I will talk about some properties of this group later. And it turns out that under certain assumptions, it becomes a subject of this seminar. So it turns out to be a Pichat norm projectively approximated in the sense of the Schiffer, Glebsky, Lubotsky, and Tom. This fact in turn yields abstractions to Hamiltonian actions of certain finitely generated groups, which cannot be p-norm approximated. So these groups were discovered by Lubotsky and Oppenheim. And thus we will get abstractions to actions of finitely generated group, which is an interesting problem in symplectic geometry, kind of general problem, of course, going beyond this class of groups. Yeah. And interestingly, this approximation, so approximate representation of group of Hamiltonian diffeomorphisms, comes from Berezin-Toeplitz quantization, which is a field of mathematics in itself, with certain very nice remainders. Yeah, so somehow my task is to explain these four points and to glue them during this talk. Okay, and as I said, I will start with some preliminaries from symplectic topology. So what is the symplectic manifold? So it is an even dimensional manifold equipped with differential 2 form, which is called symplectic form, which in local coordinates has very nice expression. So sum dpi wage dqi when I runs from 1 to n. So this is a 2 form, so it acts on pairs of tangent vectors. And basically what it does with this pair, so it projects the pair of vectors to a coordinate, to the two-dimensional planes pi qi of the coordinate cross. So in each two-dimensional plane, you calculate oriented area of the parallelogram spanned by these two vectors. And so then you sum up this area, so you get value of omega on xi and that. And maybe good to know that this is an integration tool. So if you have a two form on a manifold, so you can integrate it over two-dimensional surfaces and get areas which, however, these areas have sign. So it could be positive or negative and zero, right? So somehow buying real estate in symplectic worlds, it's a tricky business if you want to get kind of apartment of positive area. So these symplectic manifolds appear in classical mechanics as phase spaces. And the main principle of classical mechanics is that energy determines evolution. So if you have a function, a Hamiltonian function, energy depending on time, probably, yeah. So in this local coordinates, you can write a Hamiltonian system, q dot equals to dhdp and p dot equals to minus dhdq. And in this way, you get family of diffeomorphisms on a manifold, which send initial condition to the solution at time t. And this is family of Hamiltonian diffeomorphisms, family of motions of classical mechanics. So the key feature of this evolution is that it preserves the symplectic form. Okay, and so let me maybe say that all these diffeomorphisms which are obtained by this construction form a group, which is called group of Hamiltonian diffeomorphisms. And there exist kind of two ways of looking at this group, but maybe, okay, so maybe before that, let's talk a little bit on symplectic manifolds. So what are interesting symplectic manifolds? So for instance, surfaces with an area form. So as I said, the symplectic form is a far-reaching generalization of area, but in dimension two, you naturally have area form on forms on oriented surfaces. And you can think that this is kind of very obvious object, which geometrically probably so, but not dynamically. So diffeomorphisms which preserve area are already complicated. So there are still many open questions about them. Yeah, so another class of symplectic manifolds are complex projective manifolds, complex projective spaces, and there are complex submanifolds. So if you wish projective Keller manifold, so the space CPN carries remarkable Keller structure, which is a pair of symplectic structure and complex structure, which together give rise to a Riemannian structure, which is called Fubini-Studi form, right? And so we can, we have in our pool of examples complex projective spaces and all complex submanifolds of complex projective spaces, so that the symplectic form from complex projective space restricts to the submanifold. We also can take products. So I think that this is the class of examples which is good for this talk. So I mean, already kind of interesting. And I also wish to define a bracket on the space of functions. So if I have a pair of functions, I can produce another function f bracket g, it's Poisson bracket, which is given by expression df dq dg dp minus df dp dg dq, also in local coordinates pq. And it, if you wish, measures derivative of f along the Hamiltonian flow of g. So that's the class of manifolds and geometric structures which we consider, and the key object of interest for us is the group of Hamiltonian diffeomorphisms. So I define that, if you wish, as admissible motions of classical mechanics, right? So via Hamiltonian functions. But if first cohomology group of a manifold vanishes, so then this is just the identity component of the group of all symplectomorphisms. So this is the place where geometry, kind of this viewpoint, coming back to Klein's program, right? So group of symmetries of geometric structure actually meets dynamics, and we have motions of classical mechanics. So it's very useful to think about this group gamma from omega as infinite dimensional Lie group. And actually, its Lie algebra is just the space of smooth functions on a manifold with zero mean. So let me emphasize that I'm talking about closed symplectic manifolds. And the Lie bracket is exactly this Poisson bracket, which I just defined, right? So as a derivative of function along the flow of another function. So apparently this operation is antisymmetric and gives us the Lie bracket on this infinite dimensional Lie group. Okay, and of course, I mean, what one-
The question about smoothness.
Yes.
We're looking at diffeomorphism, so you really mean once differentiable?
No, I mean C infinity.
Everything's C infinity, okay.
Yeah, so everything in my talk is C infinity, and if you wish that this is infinite dimensional Lie group, so I'm not basically specifying topology, I'm working in with this object in the sense of, if you wish, diffeology. So I know what are smooth families, smooth two parametric families, and so on. Okay. But this intuition is very important. So somehow it's useful to view this as infinite dimensional Lie group. Okay, at least kind of on the formal level. So now there are several things known about this group. So first of all, algebra of this group, which is in a sense main topic of this talk. So the first kind of serious result goes back to Banyaga's work of 1978. So Banyaga proved, following earlier results of Thurston and Michel Herman for volume preserving diffeomorphism, that this is a simple group. So basically there are only trivial normal subgroup and the group itself, no other normal subgroups. So now this group is known to have non-trivial quasimorphisms. So this was observed by several people in already in, I would say, 21st century. So Vividentov, Gissin, Gambadoy, Shiluhin proved that non-trivial quasimorphisms admit.
Oh, you haven't defined quasimorphism yet.
Yes, quasimorphism, and I will not. So quasimorphism is approximate homomorphism from a group to real numbers. So a function which, let's say, is homogeneous and which satisfies f of x minus f of y, f of x y minus f of x minus f of y, absolute value is uniformly bounded on the group. So kind of homomorphism up to a bounded error. Okay, and another algebraic issue which was studied for groups of Hamiltonian diffeomorphisms. So constraints, or first of all, constraints on torsion. So again, so it was old work of mine and recent work of Atala and Shiluhin. So some constraints on finitely generated subgroups, including non-uniform lattices, and I would say symplectic facets of Zimmer program. And what will happen in this talk, as I said, so we will find some constraints on actions on certain groups, okay? So that's something which I wish to explain at the end of the day. Okay, and finally, result which I wish to mention, that there are kind of positive results. So certain groups, which are called right angle arcing groups, do act. So this is a result by Misha Kapovich. And roughly speaking, you start with a graph and you choose generator according vertices. And so you have commutation relations according ages. And that's basically what these rocks are. So that's very nice result.
So sorry, I'm trying to follow it. So act means there's a symplectic manifold on which this group would act as symplectomorphism. Is that what you mean?
Yes, it's actually, I think Kapovich proved stronger facts that any rock acts on any symplectic manifold by Hamiltonian
morphisms. And the action... and the notion of quasi-morphisms, only morphisms into the reals. If you looked into other groups, it would be more like the seminar, actually.
Yes. So only to the reals. Okay. So sorry. I mean, I can probably give the full lecture about quasimorphisms. It's kind of favorite subject, but I simply wanted to make the following point that algebraic considerations are kind of not. I mean, let's put it differently: that the group of Hamiltonian diffeomorphisms is not a stranger for algebraic considerations. And that's exactly what I'm going to do now, kind of in a very, very special direction, which you will see.
So, Leonid, in particular, every RAG group as a non-trivial quasi-homomorphism, that was known before?
No, that I did not say, because I don't know what is the restriction. So it could lie kind of...
Yeah, if you have a full graph, this is just Z to the N, and then they shouldn't have, right?
Yes, so on Z to the N, of course, you don't have nothing non-trivial, right? And actually actions of, if you wish, actions of Z in the power N on symplectic manifolds are not also very interesting. So you take on balls, disjoint, and you just choose your favorite Hamiltonian diffeomorphism supported in the ball. So note that actually this group of Hamiltonian diffeomorphisms on the nose looks very flexible because you can choose Hamiltonian, right? And Hamiltonian could be kind of localized. Okay. On the other hand, there is a lot of symplectic rigidity, and there is the whole kind of story. I will comment at the end, but I have nothing intelligent to say about this in the context of this talk. There is the full story, which started from work of Helmut Hofer about geometry of the group of Hamiltonian diffeomorphisms. It's very interesting geometric object. So any more questions, please?
Yeah, so what do you mean that rags do act on them in this sense?
So this means that there exists a non-trivial faithful action of this rag. There exists a monomorphism of this group into group of Hamiltonian diffeomorphisms. And for the case of Zn, I described you.
So it is, this fact is for every rag?
Yes, it's Misha Kapovich theorem, actually non-trivial. Of course, not for Zn, but for kind of general rag, yeah. Okay, so let me go a little bit further. Okay, so now Schatten norm. So Schatten norm is kind of analog of LP norm on operators, right? So we take pth power of absolute value of operator, take trace in the power 1/p. And I will denote by delta p the correspondence distance on the projectivization of the unitary group. Okay, so now here is the key definition. I will say that the group gamma, so think about, is p-norm projectively approximated if there exists a sequence of maps, rho k, from gamma to pu of hk when k goes to infinity, and of course, I mean, dimension also goes to infinity. And here are two key properties. So first property is that limit of delta p rho k of x rho k of y to rho k of x y is zero. So this thing becomes kind of eventually a representation, right? So, but closer and closer to representation, okay? And that is faithful, meaning that lim inf delta p rho k of x1 is bounded away from zero for every x. So that's the object. And the definition goes back to more general situation for kind of general sequences of groups equipped with B invariant matrix. And that's due to the Schiffer, Glebsky, Lubotsky, and Toh. So now the more mainstream object is unitary asymptotic representation. So we need this projective representations for a good reason. And this will be a kind of tiny adjustment of the story. And we will use a theorem due to Lubotsky and Oppenheim that for every P between one and plus infinity excluded, there exists finitely presented non-P norm projectively approximated group. So again, they formulated result for unitary approximate representation, but the proof goes kind of literally, okay? So somehow what is important for me that I'm talking not for an empty class of objects, okay? But I will discuss this group a little bit, yeah? So let me just use the notation PLOP, so projective Lubotsky-Oppenheim, so for this class of group and P is fixed. So now, remarkably, so the result is unknown for plus infinity. We will talk about this. So that's why I understand that's one of the conjectures which Alex mentioned in the beginning of the seminar. Find the conflict in a sense between this theorem and some story about Hamiltonian diffeomorphism. So what I want to do, so I want to say a couple of words about construction of this group. So it's kind of amateur sketch. So that's more or less what I understood from the work of Alex and his collaborators, which I mentioned today. So we start with a non-principal ultra filter and consider ultra product of spaces of matrices kind of Kn times Kn with Schatten norm. And the point is that every asymptotic projective representation of gamma yields a genuine isometric representation of gamma on this ultra product by conjugation. And this is very nice because when I'm considering representation by conjugation, I do not care original representation was just representation or projective representation because this factor e in the power I theta goes. And so that's the proposition due to Schiffer, Glebsky, Lubotsky, and Toh. Let gamma be a finitely presented group with the following properties. So its second cohomology in this representation vanishes and gamma is not residually finite. So then it belongs to this class. So it cannot be P norm approximated. So the argument goes roughly speaking like this. So that's very, very rough sketch. So this condition A guarantees stability. So a kind of Newton type process guarantees that for almost all integers in the sense of ultra filter, there is a kind of genuine representation of gamma on this matrix group. And moreover, every X, which is not the identity, for almost all N do not lie in its kernel. And so in this way, we get kind of residual linearity of the group, but it was assumed to be not residually finite. And every linear group is residually finite by Maltsev theorem. So somehow this contradiction proves this proposition. On the other hand, there is, of course, a big deal to construct groups gamma which satisfy this property. And construction of gamma goes in two steps. So one starts with the co-compact lattice in simple Lie group of high rank over eliadic numbers. And then there is a remarkable step. So one should take a finite central extension of gamma zero, so Allais-Deligne, which basically makes new group not residually finite. And a specific example is certain lattice. So the one you see, it's kind of quaternionic unitary group with coefficients in z extended by square root of minus one and one over pi. One over p, sorry. So this is a co-compact lattice in sp to n in periodic world. So now with such groups, verification of H2 of condition H2 of gamma pi p, so this condition, right, goes geometrically via the action.
Can I interrupt again? Yep.
Yes, of course.
And also, Alex, I have a question. Yes. So. Firstly, are you going to be using, is it important to you this happens to be a symplectic group? Was that irrelevant to you?
No, for me, it's irrelevant. It's that's example.
Okay. So I'm curious, Alex, in this example, using these arithmetic groups, I've forgotten what, so you needed the mean construction, and then you needed, why was it had to be symplectic?
No. We combine, I mean, there are three issues. We need the Garland, kind of a generalization of the Garland method in order to prove the vanishing of H2.
That's quite general.
Right. Well, it's general.
In higher rank. Yeah.
But in higher rank, well, in the periodic, over the reals, we don't know to do that.
Yeah, right. I understand that.
And now, but you see, if you just take arithmetic lattices, they're residually finite, so you did nothing.
Yeah, right.
So then we have to jump over to the work of Deligne, imitate some work that Deligne did over the reals, so we have to imitate this over the periodics, and then the combination of the two, namely Garland from the periodic and Deligne converted to the periodic, gave us the example.
Yeah, my only question is the symplectic intrinsic here?
No, not at all. Okay, this is just a case where you can do in the symplectic. Well, these cases, no, I think you can. I'm not sure if you can do it with SLN, but it's.
But since this talk is about symplectic geometry, I'm trying.
I think it's accidental here.
This is an accident. Sorry, yes, I shut up.
Accident, but I just thought that for the Deligne, it's important that kind of there is this Maslov index, and you can take.
Yeah, but you need well.
Certain
I think
cover of a sphere.
Yeah, you need that there exists an infinite. That the Lie group is an infinite cover.
An infinite central cover.
Hermitian, but if you take some other Hermitian forms, there are very few other, but in principle, I think you could do it with others also.
Mm-hmm. Okay, thanks.
Okay, and so this H2 uses some geometry, also the Banach geometry of Schatten norms. So somehow the fact that Schatten norms are in a sense kind of close to Hilbert spaces, right? So saves the game. So as far as I understand, so that's exactly the place where you cannot work with operator norm, right? Alex, am I correct?
Right. We don't know to prove such vanishing results for the operator norm.
Yes, and my life is as follows.
If we could prove it, this would solve a major open problem. But in fact, from the lectures that we heard in the last few weeks from Shmuel Weinberger and from Dalart, at least for some of these lattices, it's not true. The H2 of gamma is not necessarily zero. I'm not claiming that it's not necessarily zero in this particular representation, but the Galan method, when it gives you zero, it gives you always zero, you know, in any representation.
I see. Okay, because what happens with kind of me, as you will see, I would prefer P equal to infinity, but I can survive with large P.
Right.
So that's, okay. I mean, I will show you. So that's the point. Yeah. Okay. So now let's go to the class of symplectic manifolds, which we consider. So we work on closed Keller manifolds. So most probably the story works also for not Keller, but it's we did not complete everything here. So we need it to be quantizable. That's absolutely crucial. So this means that the cohomology class of symplectic form divided by 2 pi is integral. And first Chern class is even on kernel of the symplectic form. It's unclear to me. It's a technical condition, important condition, but we will keep this condition for the whole kind of story. And example is, for instance, CPN or closed complex curves, where H2 of M is actually one dimensional. So C1 of TM simply vanishes on kernel of omega. So I mean, there are good examples where these conditions is kind of valid. And so here is the theorem, which we proved with Laurent-Schaar. If P is bigger than N, N is this kind of complex dimension of the scalar manifold. So then the group gamma of M omega is P norm projectively approximate. And immediate corollary is the following, that these groups from class P LOP, so non-P norm projectively approximated groups, do not admit a faithful Hamiltonian action on M to N omega. Because otherwise, with this quantization, they would be P norm projectively approximated, and they are not. Okay. So that's main rigorous formulations of main results in this story. And the idea of proof is quantization.
And by the way, Leonid, this theorem of Hurwitz-Charles, of P greater than N, this is also true for infinity?
Yes.
Uh-huh. So every subgroup of this group is infinity approximated. Oh, that's very interesting.
Oh, I even did not, yes. I see.
You see, usually we cannot, we mentioned this in this seminar many times, this problem of approximation as well as stability, if you know it for one P, you can deduce nothing for another P. You know, it's kind of, it's uncountably many different problems for every single group. Because you see, if you take a approximation to unitary group, which are almost homomorphism with respect to one P, and you take another one, maybe they are still homomorphism, but maybe it's not faithful anymore.
Mm-hmm.
Or vice versa.
So, okay, you will see. Yeah. You will see
And I'm, since I'm really getting interested here, because you're marrying quantization with this. So one of the problems of quantization is you don't have a homomorphism into the diffeomorphism group because you don't have canonical quantization. So the whole point here is you're going to exploit this approximation.
Yes, so I will.
That's amazing. Dirac would be very excited.
okay. I will kind of try to explain this point. So that's one of the things I prepared to talk about. Okay, so quantization. But let me start again because I was asked to be not very technical. So I will start with some kind of romantic, but then I will formulate precisely which quantization I need. So what is quantization? So it's mathematics behind quantum classical correspondence, and quantum classical correspondence is a principle that quantum mechanics contain classical in the limit h bar goes to zero. And so what is the mathematical model of finite volume quantum mechanics? So you have finite dimensional Hilbert space complex. You have Hermitian operators on this space denoted by L of H. Density operators are positive trace one operators. And you have a number h bar, which is Planck constant. And so now comes this table, which explains what this quantum classical correspondence is about. So in classical world, you live on a symplectic manifold m omega, and in quantum, on this complex, let's say finite dimensional Hilbert space. So now observables are functions in classical world and Hermitian operators in quantum mechanical world. So states are probability measures on M and density operators in quantum world. And there is bracket, which is Poisson bracket in classical world, and properly normalized commutator by I divided by h bar in the quantum world. Okay, so that's
why have you insisted finite dimensional?
Because quantization, I would put it in the following way, a rigorous story, which I know. So it works for closed manifold and hence for finite dimensional spaces. And I think the only non-closed manifold for which I can repeat the story is basically R2N. But I mean, there are people who do infinite volume symplectic manifolds, and then the spaces are infinite dimensional right away, right? So you remember that you have one dimension per quantum cell. So if volume is finite, you have a Hilbert space of huge dimension, like one over h bar in the power n. Peter, does it answer the question? Okay. So analysis is simpler. So there is no doubts about this. Okay. So let me remind very briefly. So again. So just to entertain you. So how people found quantum mechanics. So let me start with the attribute of a spinning body, which is called angular momentum. So it has phase space on the sphere. Right, and basically angular momentum depends on angular velocity and shape. So you see here momentum of a skater who spread her arms, but when the shape of the body changes, so somehow she brings the arms toward the body, so the angular momentum grows. So now the Poisson bracket relations for classical angular momentum are just cyclic permutations of the kind L1, L2, Poisson bracket equals to L3, and so on. So now this view of angular momentum, classical view of angular momentum, was refuted by famous Stern-Gerlach experiment in 1922. So they sent a beam of silver atoms through inhomogeneous magnetic field and basically witnessed the following thing, that that all the particles concentrated at two points on the photographic paper. So meaning that angular momentum tend to had just two values, up and down. And actually this contradicted to classical prediction that L3 belongs to the interval. So now quantum mechanics resolves this contradiction and resolves it in the following way, that if you have a quantum observable, so to consider it spectral decomposition, some lambda JPJ, so this PJ are pairwise orthogonal projectors, and then in a state rho, A takes values lambda J with probability trace PJ rho, okay? So this very much fits this example of quantized angular momentum. So if your Hilbert space is C2 and L1, L2, L3 hat, a kind of quantized coordinates of angular momentum, which are just Pauli matrices. So they have the kind of similar commutation relations and take two eigenvalues plus minus one, which exactly correspond to these two dots in Stern-Gerlach experiment. So it's a beautiful story, which immediately gives rise to paradox. So for instance, if we measure projections of this angular momentum on three vectors u, v, and w is drawn here. So the sum is zero, but values are plus and minus one, and you obviously cannot find three numbers which sum up to zero whose values are plus minus one. So this means that something is not very good here in this model. And I mean, this is a deep philosophical question actually, but explanation is that one cannot measure simultaneously non-commuting operators. And I will present you uncertainty principle, so which highlights new role of the bracket, so unseen role of the bracket in classical mechanics, which says that variance of A and rho, so remember that observables at state in state is a kind of random variable, has statistical meaning, times variance of B in rho is greater or equal than 1/4 trace of commutator AB rho square. So why I'm telling you this? So the reason is simple. So there is no precise quantization. So that's exactly what Peter mentioned, yes. And this is, if you wish, a physical explanation why there is no such an object. And of course, I mean, there is also not very hard mathematical explanation. So after all, you cannot embed kind of honestly huge group of Hamiltonian diffeomorphisms into the unitary group, okay? But interestingly enough, so this is not a trap because what you can do, there exists approximate morphisms. So exactly as in this kind of algebraic story about approximate representation, so one can view quantization as an approximate morphism from let's start with algebra of functions to kind of algebra to unitary algebra, to algebra of Hermitian iterators, right? So what do we have? We have a sequence of positive number of order 1/k. K is large parameter, and this h bar k is like Planck constant. We have a fine sequence of finite dimensional Hilbert spaces HK of growing dimension, and R linear maps from C infinity of M to L of HK, which send one to the identity operator with three properties. So first of all, you have norm correspondence. So operator norm correspond to uniform norm. So this norm is just uniform norm of function up to capital O 1/k. Bracket correspondence, commutator corresponds to HK divided by I, QK of the Poisson bracket plus remainder capital O of 1/k cube. And you have dimension formula that dimension of HK is like K over 2 pi in the power N volume M omega plus capital O K in the power N minus one. And so here something should be said. And it should be said the following thing. So first of all these remainders, they are not uniform, they depend on functions. Because I mean, with uniform remainders, you cannot kind of survive, such gadget doesn't exist. But in this fine, so why this quantization is called fine? Because there is something very special in it, that this remainder is capital O 1/k cube, as opposed to capital O of 1/k square for most quantizations. And one of the kind of, I would say, one of the discoveries of, early work of Laurent Charles, for instance, that in some situations, such fine quantization exists. And in this work, we pushed this fine quantizations to a slightly bigger class of example.
Can I understand this? You are quantizing the whole In quantum mechanics, I mean, you want to usually quantize a Hamiltonian. That's why I was getting confused with infinite dimensions. Now we're quantizing a diffeomorphism, and you were quantizing.
No. So far, at this point, we're quantizing functions, not yet diffeomorphic. Okay, diffeomorphisms will be later.
Maybe you return on. What is the special statement you're making? So if you're a physicist, they can quantize anything, right? So
yes, physicists can quantize anything, but this is mathematics. So
So what's this 1/k³? Can you say what special?
Yes. So first of all, let's agree that functions are Hamiltonians in classical mechanics.
Yeah.
And Hermitian operators are Hamiltonian in quantum mechanics. Mm-hmm. So we send functions to Hermitian operators. Mm-hmm. In such a way that commutator of operators correspond to Poisson bracket.
Right.
So until this is very good, but cannot exist. So I have to add remainder, which depends on f and g.
Right.
But now, which kind of remainder? So in usual kind of Bayesian-Toeplitz quantization, so if you at random open literature on Bayesian-Toeplitz quantization, you will find this result with capital O of 1/k².
Right,
and this will be bad. This will not permit me to quantize.
Again, what's your special assumption which allows you to achieve this?
So first of all, I did not explain what is Q, and there is this assumption on symplectic manifold that.
So that's what's doing it. That's
13 classes even on kernel of omega, right? So we need this assumption to achieve exactly this.
Okay, thank you. I wanted to know what was the source of it. Mm-hmm.
Yes, and but you will see. So I will arrive. QK is Bayesian-Toeplitz corrected by something by Laplacian. Mm-hmm. Okay, so there is some nice correction here with respect to standard Bayesian-Toeplitz. So somehow this QK is constructed into two steps and. I would say that in some situations, so QK already was constructed earlier by Laurent, but we extended this to slightly more general and nicer class of symplectic manifolds. Okay. So, for instance, to all projective spaces. So, very good. So this is what is called fine quantization, and so then this theorem. So assume that we have closed Keller manifold, quantizable, dimension 2n, first term class is even on kernel. So then theorem, our theorem with Laurent, then M admits a fine quantization. Okay, so that's what I mean. I will explain a little bit later how one gets there. Okay. Any questions so far? I mean, please, more questions. Okay, so if not, I will continue. So now I have to explain how do we quantize symplectomorphism. And we quantize symplectomorphism in the following way. So we take, first of all, Hamiltonian, generating Hamiltonian flow phi t, with time one map even given to given symplectomorphism phi. And importantly, we view this picture not on the group Gam, but on the universal cover of this group. And universal cover exactly understood in the sense of diffeology. So we know what are smooth paths on the group, we know what are smooth families of diffeomorphism. So that's how universal cover is understood. And then I will first lift element of this universal cover, so kind of paths of Hamiltonian diffeomorphisms with up to homotopies with fixed endpoints. And I'm doing this as physics prescribes this. So we just consider Schrödinger equation, right? So equation describing quantum evolution with replacing classical Hamiltonian FT by quantum Hamiltonian by QK of FT. And so there you go. So this is Schrödinger equation UK dot equals to minus I divided by HK QK of FT UK with the initial condition UK of zero equal to identity. So you get UK of one quantization of phi tilde from gamma tilde. And actually, of course, I mean, so far it miserably depends on the choice of path. If I will choose another path joining identity with phi, we'll get another quantization. But another problem which I get that even if I will somehow solve the problem about homotopic paths with fixed endpoints, so we will have to take into account this effect of fundamental group. So I mean, there are kind of two difficulties. So first difficulty is obvious. So basically I can arrive to given Hamiltonian diffeomorphism in many ways, and actually even topologically in many ways, so by non-homotopic paths. So let's see what we have in this respect. So here is theorem. So assume that this mu k, so all this construction comes from fine quantization. So fine quantization is quantization where bracket correspondence has this remarkable remainder. So then unitaries which I get via two different choices of paths, which are homotopic with fixed endpoints, satisfy operator norm mu k of phi tilde minus mu k prime of phi tilde is capital O 1 over k. So here where 1 over k cube is used. And second, we have this almost kind of representation property that product mu k of phi tilde mu k of psi tilde minus mu k of phi tilde psi tilde is capital O 1 over k. And third, that if phi is not identity, take any lift, mu k of phi tilde minus one in operator norm is actually bounded away by 1/2 plus something. Okay, so somehow this representation is pretty much faithful. Okay, this almost, so you see that two is basically that this is almost representation, and three that this is faithful. But still for gamma tilde, so we are not yet on gamma. Okay, and maybe, you know, you should view the following example kind of in, to have the following example in mind. So imagine as a symplectic manifold two-dimensional sphere. And let's start rotating the sphere around kind of vertical axis. So one turn rotation, as we all know, is not homotopic to the identity, right? Even in the class of all area preserving maps. But two turn rotation already becomes homotopic. But you can come up with more complicated manifolds. So for instance, if you have certain blowups of CP2, right? So at one point, so you already have kind of symplectic loops of Hamiltonian diffeomorphisms of infinite order. Fundamental group of the group of Hamiltonian diffeomorphisms exists sometimes, and this is I don't know, you can love it or you can consider it as an enemy, so somehow it object which one must take into consideration. Okay, but first of all, some ideas of the proof. So one and two, actually you basically use what is called Yegorov theorem, statement of the kind that quantization intertwines between Hamiltonian and Schrodinger evolutions up to small error. And this error is very crucial. So the fact that we work with fine quantization is very crucial. To get here this capital O of one over K. So actually without fine quantization, you simply will get capital O one, which is very bad thing, right? So you lose it, you lost it. So no kind of representation.
In the work of Constant, for example, where he has all this discussion of geometric quantization, where he tries to make such things and fix up this correction term. Does this issue, did they resolve this? I mean, this seems very interesting. I've never seen this correction.
Okay,
unless you start off with Weyl quantization, something that's canonical.
I will tell you in a couple of seconds what I'm doing.
I'm still trying to understand the miracle of this one over k cubed. How special is it? Have people seen that other than you guys before? I'm not familiar with them.
Yeah. So somehow, apparently, it was hidden in some slightly less general case than I'm discussing today, in a paper by Charles of 2007 or something like this, right? But somewhere in the middle.
Okay.
So somehow you see it as always, right? So importance was not very, very clear. So let me arrive to this. I really plan to say a word about this. Okay. And this statement about, I mean, why this is a faithful representation. So it's kind of uses nice idea, which comes back to kind of symplectic topology. So we're not using symplectic topology, but it was miraculously used for purposes of symplectic topology in 1990 paper by Hofer. So if you have diffeomorphism, which is not identity, then it displaces something. And then there are kind of many ways to understand how large, I mean, what happens in this set, what are invariants of this set which you are displacing. And in particular, this UK orthogonalizes a state. You can think about coherent state supported in this ball. I will try to say this slightly kind of more precisely. Okay. And now comes this idea about p-norm approximation. So operator norm is less or equal than Schatten norm is less or equal than dk in the power one over p times operator norm. But dk dimension grows, but grows in controlled way, like k in the power n, when n is half of real dimension of m. And so then when you kind of substitute, you get this term k in the power n and the power one over p times k inverse. So this k inverse becomes crucial. And this tends to zero when p is large. So as you see in operator norm, I simply can stop here. But in Schatten norm, when p is large, I'm still surviving with slightly worse asymptotics, but we do not care about this asymptotics and the definition of asymptotic representation. Okay. So that's basically how the story looks like. So now I will probably skip this slide because it's more technical. And so this is explanation how we struggled with the loops. So remember that so far we found asymptotic representation of gam tilde and you wish to pass to gam. And this is technically complicated story about sharp quantum propagation due to Charles and Lifloch, very recent results. But as an outcome, this mu k which we constructed descends to projective asymptotic representation. So appearance of the word projective in my talk is due to the fact that kind of on the nose construction deals with universal cover of the group of Hamiltonian diffeomorphisms. Okay. So now I'm going towards preliminaries, but I will probably kind of emphasize this point which Peter asked me. So this is standard material. We start with closed Keller manifold, quantizable. So meaning that omega divided by 2 pi is integral class. We take a holomorphic Hermitian line bundle over M, so that the curvature of some remarkable connection which lives on this bundle and this kind of associated with Hermitian structure and complex structure is I times our symplectic form. And then, so how we are quantizing? So we have to come up with two objects, right? So first Hilbert space and second operator which corresponds to function. And so far, so Hilbert space will be just as usually the space of holomorphic sections of this bundle. And operator will be defined as follows. So note that I'm defining slightly different operator. It's called Toeplitz operator. It's not QK, which I just defined, okay? So I will define QK for you in two steps. So first steps is just standard Toeplitz operation, and this is a remarkably simple construction. So how you should view it? So here you have the space V, which is just L2 space of all L2 sections. Very, very flexible object. It's very well known since this Hofer's work of 1990 that there is no kind of measure theoretic symplectic topology. Okay, so it kind of basically descends to volume topology. But there is a super rigid object which lives in this space. It's the space of holomorphic section. And pi is projection. And so a great vision of Berezin was that you can quantize in the following manner. You take holomorphic section, you multiply it by smooth function. Of course, I mean, it's not very good because the section becomes not holomorphic at this point. And then you project back orthogonally to the space of holomorphic section. So in this way, you get Toeplitz operator th bar of f, yeah, which satisfies kind of many nice axioms, but not yet this miraculous correspondence principle, right? So it satisfies correspondence principle with capital O of 1 over k square due to the work of Boardman, Meinrenken, and Schlichenmeier of 94, which in turn was built on the work on Boutain and Manvelian gaming. And what I want to, but let's first try to digest this construction because it's a very nice construction kind of, yeah? And what we want to say that this quantization is a kind of variation on the theme of Kadaira embedding theorem. Because if you have such a Keller manifold with this, which is quantizable, so let's say with these conditions, so now to every point on the manifold, you can associate a hyperplane in the space of sections. So looking at sections which vanish at this point. Okay, and so then define coherent state projector to be just projector to the line orthogonal to this point. So this is the notion of coherent state living over a point of symplectic manifold, of Keller manifold. And so then, as a matter of fact, so there exists a Ronsley function, which is kind of almost constant. So here equality sign is missing. So that th bar of f equals to integral over m f of z rh bar of z p z h bar d volume z. So you integrate basically your function with some weight over this coherent state projectors. And why this is important? Because this explains, roughly speaking, how displacement yields orthogonalization. So you have, if you have a non-trivial symplectomorphism, so you start with a coherent state, yeah, which is concentrated like a kind of Gaussian near its center. And so if symplectomorphism displaces this domain, so the corresponding unitary iteration basically orthogonalizes this coherent state as you see at this picture. Okay. So any questions up to this point? Okay. And so now how we construct fine quantization. So we start with the same assumption. So C1 is even on kernel of omega. And we do the following thing. So that there are two tricks. So first you start with Berezin Toeplitz quantization, but not for L in the power K, but kind of you twist L in the power K by vector bundle, line bundle E with very special value of Chern class, which comes from this construction. And so that's trick number one. And trick number two is that after you did this, you shift HK by K plus lambda, where lambda is kind of from this formula. Yeah, so C Chern class over two minus lambda C1 of L is integer class. And you correct Toeplitz operator by 1/4K times Laplacian of F. So you twist this Toeplitz quantization operators by Laplacian. So this twist was present in original Laurent's paper. And in this way, you get the fine quantization. So somehow you kill the term at 1/K square in the bracket correspondence.
Yeah.
Yes, please.
Yeah, it reminds me a lot of in when you do some of these things in homogeneous spaces where you have to shift various operators by constants in order to make formulae much more exact. I'd imagine that if you if you want to quantize the geodesic flow on a hyperbolic surface, the natural representation theoretic constants you should shift by that look very similar to this. But you, of course, working in a much more general situation.
Yes, but I would say that on the sphere, so on a round sphere, it's exactly the trick you are kind of talking about, I believe. Yeah,
it's very interesting. Yeah.
Okay, so that's almost the end of the story. So I wish to end up, I still have a couple of minutes, so I wish to end up with some discussion. Okay, so first of all, what we do not know. So first question is whether Lubotsky-Eppingham group can act in a volume-preserving manner. So somebody can prove a more general theorem. This I don't know, and I think I for this specific kind of eladic lattices, I talked to David Fisher, so far there is no result in the spirit of Zimmer conjecture that these lattices can attack. Okay, so this is of course interesting question. So there is the question which already sound here, so are there real as opposed to eladic lattices in this class projective Lubotsky-Eppingham P? And there is this major question, so is this class PLO infinity, so non-operator norm approximated groups non-empty? So as I said, for me, this will be kind of very pleasant story. So that's kind of first bit of the discussion, and second bit of the discussion.
No, the third one is a well-known.
Yes.
By Kirchberg. I mean, in fact, Kirchberg conjecture that it's empty, namely that everything. But I think now people don't believe it anymore.
Mm-hmm. Okay, and so the last slide is a kind of attempt to tell you what we do not know. Okay, so this, I would say that's what you do not know. And this is what we do not know. Okay, so, and what we do not know.
May I ask you a kind of a semi-philosophical question?
Yes, of course.
You know, in the Zimmer program, usually it goes like that if you have a lattice in a very high rank lattice, then you don't let it act on smaller manifolds somehow, you know. That's usually the type of conjecture that, you know, it of course can act on G mod the gamma or something like that, but not on smaller. Now, in these periodic groups, there is something strange which you didn't really mention here. And I don't know whether this is really essential or this is our ignorance. When we prove, you know, you quoted my results with Oppenheim, but we really were able to prove it for lattices in SP 2G QP, where P is now the prime, not your P. The P of the number theory. When P is very, very, very large, you know, we have to take, we let P go to infinity in some sense. So somehow,
yes, so
there is, but the rank is the same. So it's kind of a going horizontally rather than going vertically. Is there something like that, a difference like that between groups? You see, somehow we have a philosophy which distinguish between a very, very high rank and small rank. But I don't have a philosophy which distinguish when the prime P goes to infinity. But in practice, there is a difference in the proof, but maybe it's only our ignorance.
You see, Alex, so here is the story. So a while ago, I proved some versions of Hamiltonian Zimmer conjecture for non-uniform lattices. And their phenomenon was like this. So dimension did not play a role at all, but what played a role, the following. So first of all, I worked on manifolds with vanishing pi 2. And then I looked at kind of growth of fundamental of symplectic form on the universal cover of the manifold. So if you wish, the isoperimetric inequality on the universal cover controlled abstractions to actions of non-uniform lattices. And what was the kind of the game that in non-uniform lattices you have distorted elements, yes, by your theorem with Moses and Rubinathan, right? So, right? So, yes, and so this distorted element by some reason simply cannot exist in Hamiltonian groups because Hamiltonian groups have certain kind of metrics in the spirit of Hofer's metrics or something which I will say last, this is last slide basically, right? And so then you can prove that on certain manifolds there is no distortion. Okay, and so then something is distorted and then you use this Margulis finiteness theorem and you basically prove whatever you wish. Okay, so now in this quantization story, the dimension, as you see, entered because this P Lubotsky-Epping game, right? So somehow P depends on the dimension. And I think that philosophy is the following, that quantization is weaker than symplectic topology, but better than nothing. And so somehow it is a kind of thin layer between what symplectic topological methods can do and kind of general dynamical methods can do in Hamiltonian context, okay? So that's what I can say. I mean, there are pros and, I mean, answering to your question, there are pros and cons. So maybe it is correct. I mean, maybe dimension should enter and maybe it should not enter, right? So I don't know, kind of. I know situations when for non-co-compact lattices and some classes of symplectic manifolds where dimension does not enter. Okay, I still, do you have 1 minute, Alex?
Oh yeah, you have more than one. It's only 6:15. Okay, yeah, sure, go ahead.
So I just wanted to say the following thing, that the group of Hamm carries very interesting geometry, which is Hofer's geometry. It's being very Finsler metric associated to uniform norm on the Lie algebra. And this is a central object of modern symplectic topology with interesting coarse geometry, okay? And it becomes, in the context of quantization, completely elusive. So what do I mean? I mean the following thing. So we have this P-Schatten distance, right? But I think that the difference between P-Schatten distance and operator distance is that, let's say, unitary group with P-Schatten distance is unbounded. So diameter becomes kind of infinite. And so let's normalize the diameter. So let's multiply this Schatten distance by k in the power minus n in the power p. And in the infinite case, we'll just leave it because when you define by infinity, you get zero. And so question is, do we still have approximation in this case? I mean, approximation for our Hamiltonian group. And there is certain favor in evidence in favor of yes answer based on analysis of the displacement. So remember this coherent states and kind of displacing sets. Okay, let's buy this for a second. I will be very cautious here. It's not checked completely. But then we can play the following game. So we can take this ultra product of projective unitary group equipped with this projective distance. And we can consider it is equipped with natural distance, natural metrics. So just take limit of this Schatten metrics, yeah, in the ultra filter limit. And then if you have a hypothetical approximation, so you have a monomorphism from Hamm to this metric ultra product, right? So you basically mod out by sequences whose norms tend to zero, right? And then
even if the answer is yes.
Huh?
If the answer is yes.
Yes, if the answer is yes, but it is yes in infinity case. Okay? In infinity, if nothing changed, it is yes. And then I can ask, what is the pullback of the metric on Ham in both cases, in infinity case and in this hypothetical case? So in infinity case, we know the answer. So the pullback is discrete. We simply get kind of discrete metric on Ham. And this is a little bit kind of disappointing. But if the answer is yes, so then my conjecture is that for finite P, the answer might be related to this Halmash metric. So Halmash metric is the following metric from the kind of classical book of Halmash and ergodic theory. So you take supremum over all sets of volume of set and its symmetric image, symmetric difference with its image. So ask the question, so what is the maximal measure displaced by the diffeomorphism? And I believe that there is some kind of link, but that's, of course, I mean, a completely hypothetical thing, and this is conjecture for the future. Mm-hmm. Okay, and I'm done with this talk. Thank you very much.
Thank you very much. Thank you, Peter. Had to leave like 2-3 minutes ago, and he sent me a chat to tell you that it was a wonderful talk. Mm. And I always agree with Peter. I mean, sometimes I have to, even if I don't want, but in this case, I want to agree with him. Thank you very much. It was a great talk.
Thank you.
Any other questions? Just speak, because I don't see you guys. If somebody wants to ask, please ask. Okay, if not, then I see Michael Chapman is with us. So Michael will talk next week on the connection between quantum computation and Kohn's embedding problem. And as I said, he also promised to explain why there is a counterexample for algebras, but not for group algebras. And the talk will be therefore somewhat longer than the usual one. Okay, see you next week.